Father, we stand here together in one accord. We praise you for your kindness. We praise you for who you are. As you're about to go through your word, we ask your spirit to interpret this word and your anointing to be with us. Jesus, let your angels to surround this place in front and behind, so that this word may have place in the heart of your people. I reject the work of the devourer. I rebuke in the name of Jesus Christ, and I take authority in the name of Jesus. May your anointing be upon me and your fire as I speak your word. In Jesus' name we say, Amen. You may be seated and clap your hands. Somebody say amen. God is good. And all the time. What did we share last Sunday? Jezebel's spirit. What did I say Jezebel's spirit does?
Stay alive.
Still alive, still active. When I was talking, because as the spirit does not die, I want you to know this clear. Because God is a spirit and devil is a spirit. Therefore, they are all eternal. Actually, devil gonna be eternal forever in hell. Okay? Devil gonna live forever in hell. And I always tell people sometimes when someone threaten you, particularly when you're in a dream, in particular some dream trying to threaten you, or some demons or people threaten you, just inform them, devil, you have already a special place for you in hell. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Devil doesn't want to hear that. He'll tell you, if you do this, I'll kill you. If you do this, you know, that's a devil. You have one good reserved place already for you in hell. We have a place reserved for us already in heaven. Somebody say,
I have a place.
In heaven. Now, where there are some believers who go to the church and say, I don't think I'll go to heaven. You need a good spark of deliverance. Tell
neighbor,
you go to heaven. Another one says, sure. If someone says, sure. The Bible says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. But when you believe in Christ Jesus with all your heart, mind, soul, and spirit, you have a place in heaven. Let me tell you, if you hear Pastor Lon Wax and goes, don't cry. I'm going to stretch for this one good measure for me. Somebody say amen. I have a good one. I remember this one time the Spirit of God was talking to me clearly. I remember one time I was sitting to a seal and just sitting home. And I could just feel this. There is freedom. And when you feel that, you have that boldness that every second you are spending for God is to decorate your crown. Okay? The extra. You see, when you already finish, the art people, when they finish already to put the shape, and then they start to put some painting to paint this one to make it look nice. My crown, I just every day put another one. Don't be jealous. You have yours.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Can I hear amen?
Amen.
Okay, believing in Jesus, we have eternal life, but receiving the crown is according to what we do. To receive the eternal life, it simply doesn't cost anything just to believe in Christ Jesus, and it connects you, walk in the path of righteousness. You'll be born again. you have eternal life. But to receive a reward, the Bible said you will receive reward according to what you have done. Some people in heaven, they are heaven, they don't have anything. But they are in heaven. You will be rewarded according to what we have done. So when you do anything, that's what you are working for the crown, for the reward. I want to make this clear. There is a salvation, there is a reward. There are two things totally different. So when you will be rewarded to the good, whatever you have done, here is yours. That's why everything you do in the house of God, it is for your reward. That's what God will reward you for. Some people say, I'll receive a reward. Reward for what? Tell them, reward for what? For example, just I come and then I say, I'm rewarding you. Then he himself is going to ask me, for what? Even if he sees the reward, he's going to say, Pastor, reward for what? So whatever we do here, actually, there will be no surprise in heaven. I want to make this clear. Whatever we do here is a picture of what is there. What is there is only is right, is clear, is pure. There's no fake in it. It's totally pure. So whenever you do things, when they reward you at your workplace, don't say, oh, okay, they are rewarding the workplace. Your boss is observing you. So I would ask believers not just to come to church. I come to church. I love God. I tell God. No. Just say, Lord, I want something. I was moved yesterday. I came here tonight. I knock in the church. Around 8:30 something. I observed, I saw Brother Raymond. He didn't see me. He was here nearly 9. Together with the two children, the little children, he was cleaning the carpet, then he was cleaning the windows. I was outside, I did not eat inside. I felt so, I don't know what I can say. You know, there are those, not the compassion, you feel like, why? Okay, why? Why him? The children are there. Some of you were tough. My children have to go to bed at 7. Yeah, go to bed at 7. Children were here, 8:30, nearly 9. 2, the little boy and the little girl. And he was, I could see him screaming, swiping, stuff. And I came here in the morning, I look at the room, just saying, let me tell you, you are stepping in a place where someone, only one person, has done the work. But we've done what we can to make sure we involve the church to be able to know how to grab the blessing. We put you in a group of cleaning. Some of you, you think we are using you. Some of you, you think maybe we are trying to take advantage of you. Nearly 7 years, we've never had a group of church people to clean. It's the first time we've done it. So whether you can join the team, whether you cannot join the team, be in your mind, 7 years until now, the church has never been dirty. When I look at it, I say, Lord, please remember him. Can I amen? There are things that God put in place for us to be part of. And then there's that human pride. And then that's that human, not just pride, selfishness. The way we do. Then the way we do. I want to beg you this. Every opportunity that presents itself for you to be part to serve God, it is your benefit. Can I amen?
Amen.
Even if you have visited a particular church, just visit 1 week, and then you hear this is what they are doing. Don't be a visitor. Be part of that place. Even that one day you are in that church, do something. Because a believer will never be visitors. When you step in the house of God, you are a child of God. Now, how are you going to receive the reward? Every little thing you do, that's where your reward is hidden. So if I can reward Brother Raymond, my reward is not the way God is looking to reward him. Never. I can just reward him particular. If I can just think about rewarding him, do you see what God is sitting in heaven is looking for? Somebody say amen.
Amen.
God is sitting in heaven. Do you know what he's thinking when he's looking at him? So God is a father. It's the same way you cannot do what you can do to your own children, expect that what God will do for you. You can't have two children. One is in a room, is a boss. She's in the boss with iPad. She's in the boss with whatever. But there is another one. Mommy, come. Daddy, she's there. You yourself, regardless how good mom you are, you will reward a child who serves you. Can I amen?
Amen?
In the same way, expect that we are a family of God. And God is a great father.
Amen.
He sees what we do, and that's where reward is hidden. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
We go to the word of God. Numbers 25, verse 1 up to 5 tonight. The book of Numbers. The book of Numbers, chapter 25, verse 1 up to 9. While Israel was staying in Sidon, the man began to indulge in sexual immorality with Moabite women, who invited them to the sacrifices to their God. The people ate and bowed down before these gods. So Israel joined in worshipping the Baal of Baal, and the Lord's anger burned against them. The Lord said to Moses, take all the leaders of these people, kill them, and expose them in broad daylight before the Lord, so that the Lord's fierce anger may turn away from Israel. So Moses said to Israel, our judges, each of you must put to death those of your men who have joined in worshiping the Baal of Baal. Then an Israelite man brought to his family a Midianite woman right before the eyes of Moses and whose assembly of Israel while they were weeping at the entrance to the tent of meeting. When Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, saw this, he left the assembly, took a spear in his hand, and followed the Israelite into the tent. He drove the spear through both of them, through the Israelite, and into the woman's body. Then the plague against the Israelite was stopped. Amen. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Last Sunday I spoke about Jezebel's spirit, and I spoke how Jezebel, when she was married into the land of Israel with a man called Ahab, this woman, his father, so the father was a worshiper of Baal. So this woman came in a marriage, but she only came not only married, but she came also with a hidden agenda of introducing publicly the work of Baal in the land. And I said, Jezebel's spirit, I explained last Sunday how she controlled the country. She took over the leadership of the husband. She even started to make even signature on behalf of the husband. She killed people on behalf of the husband, trained the people how to do evil. But this woman came only for a marriage, but not for a marriage. She came with a particular agenda. And I say, Jezebel's spirit is simple, spirit of confusion, spirit of evil, spirit of just any type of evil that you can measure. So Jezebel's spirit was right in the land and right on the top of the country. And today I will speak about, be very careful, Baal. Baal. Baal, Jezebel worshipped Baal. Baal was a particular god. The meaning of Baal simply means Lord. So Baal was a particular god. In another word, a particular a particular god in another way, something they could just worship and they could consider about as a powerful god than any other little god. Actually, in the ancient time, Egypt had 155 gods, which means every nation had someone, every tribe, they have a particular thing. This one we are worshiping. This one, there was there over 155 in Egypt itself. But Baal was considered as the powerful one. Now, Jezebel and the father, they were also worshippers of Baal. So now I'm talking to the yesterday, I spoke about a worshipper of Baal who was Jezebel. But today I'm speaking about the Baal himself. Now, Baal was considered as a god of thunder, god of storm, a god of fertility, god who could give people children, god who could give rain, god who could produce something to the level people they could sacrifice whatever they needed in order to satisfy Baal. However, Baal was no real that Baal. It was just a particular thing people put there, as you know, some people until now, right now in the world, they have particular things they believe. That if I can do this one, that's how it happened. So it's something which a particular culture put in place. And they start to worship it. Actually, to the worship of Baal won't even bend, to the point people could now sacrifice even their own children, their firstborn children. And they sacrifice those who are still well, who are in good health. So it's become like a famous thing. Now, among this worship of Baal, there's one aspect of Baal that what Jezebel was part of it, and that was one aspect of sexual worship. Actually, in the time of Paul, when he wrote the book of the Corinthians, there's a particular woman who they used to worship. She was a woman, a sexual woman that the people could worship in another for pleasure, for love. And she had about that temple, they had 1,000 priests, what I call priests. And I say ladies or girls were serving in the temple with their work is a sexual work into the temple. Not the temple of God, but the temple of evil forces. Can I hear amen?
Amen.
Now, these activities continue. And that's why the scripture finished to read here. It's the book of Numbers. Now the children of Israel, they haven't yet reached the promised land. They are still in the journey to God. God is dealing with the issue of the people trying to worship the Canaanite God. And suddenly God is just angry. Suddenly another man comes to another woman to go to the tent. Bible says Phinehas was very angry. He said, can't you see what God is angry about? The Bible says he took a knife and straightforward killed the woman and the man at the same time. It became like something famous. Now, the worship of this evil, it's more of pleasure. It's more of something you think is making, it's okay. It's something that will feel, oh, this is what I'm looking for. It's something like you say, okay, this is a good one. And then turn it in a moment where people start to worship things what is evil. And that's why I say this one, please. So, because devil knows that people are behind material, because knows people are behind pleasure, because knows people are behind getting something more, so this Baal, this god Baal, as I say, fertility, production, having wealth, having a production, so many things can happen well. So he was using this in order to manipulate people. And to the point, many believers, I say many believers, the children of Israel themselves, they deserted God. It's what was God, the God, God himself was very angry. Actually, in the book of Exodus, chapter 20, what is the first commandment says? What the first commandment? One of the Ten Commandments. I'm the Lord your man. Do not have any other God before. And the second commandment says what? Now listen, the commandment, when God is giving this commandment to the children of Israel, get clear. He knew the land where he's bringing them is full of false gods. He knew that it's full of people who are worshiping now the idols. He's giving them the first warning. I am the Lord your God. Therefore,
Do not worship any other thing. He even said, don't worship any particular image. Don't worship anything. I like another scripture say, for I am a jealous God. Can I amen?
Amen.
So God, if he started to warn the Israelites, you are going in the land who I'm bringing you, do not try to be like them. Amen. And here we are in the world of today. You see what another person in that workplace say. Oh, I can do like them. You have your way you could dress yourself, could be helped with the way of dressing. Oh, I saw the way she's dressing. I can also dress like her. You have your way of doing things, and so I don't think my way of doing things is okay. Maybe mine is off. Is off? Off what? Old fashion. Then my brother is old school. Now, God knew that they are going in a land where they will find something different than theirs. Let me tell them, where I'm sending you, do not try to be like them. And a good believer is a believer who never try to be like the world.
Amen.
You just be like Jesus.
Amen.
Tell your neighbor, amen.
Amen.
You are going in a land. That land, this is how it is. It's full of milk, it's full of honey. But they don't worship me. They worship something else. Therefore, do not worship what they worship. There is nothing God is so jealous with than your heart. We are living in a world where there are so many influences of Baal. And these influences are there everywhere. And these influences affect us. But God wants you to know that you are a unique person.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Why do you think Jesus spoke to the Israelites? Don't do that, because he wanted to create a particular nation for himself. A nation that will be different than the world. And exactly when you become a born again, you become a different nation. You become a different person. Yes, you can still talk with people. You can still laugh with people. You can still exactly, but you have to know that, no, I'm a different person. How do the world know that you are a different person if you are exactly still doing exactly what they are doing? Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The practice of power was such as magic, ritual, sacrificing of little children, sexual acts. This was called about the actions. It was like something normal. And actually there are some culture, until now I was reading, there's some culture in a part of India where they can choose a little girl must have first a sexual outside in the temple before they can start to come and prepare the future marriage. And there are some culture, as I'm talking, you are a little child, they bring you somewhere. Because it's not, you will not know what is taking place. They are doing a sacrifice of Baal to you on the name of the culture. Little children, some old women, the community they will call you. They are bringing you somewhere. You don't know where you are going. In the name of the culture, that is a Baal sacrifice. That's why when I was preparing this message, God wanted me to tell you, not just you are in the house of God, but there are some Baal activities need to be broken.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You can still come as the children of Israel. There were still children of Israel in the journey, but among them they were already infiltrated with those worshiping Baal. Listen how God was very angry. He says, in your body, who committed these things must be killed and the body be exposed to the broad daylight. Listen, on that one day, God killed 24,000 people. Because God is jealous. He created you alone and he wanted to have time with you. He wanted to have an intimate moment with you. He doesn't want any other thing to interfere with you. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
As I said, in the time of Paul, there was this woman who was called Aphrodite. The Aphrodite, this was a particular idol lady, idol woman. She was a normal person before, a beautiful girl. It's a long story. However, because of that, they used her as a simple a way of promoting evil in the nation. Actually, her picture, whenever they could decorate her, is a naked girl, naked woman. And whatever what they were doing now, they're going to recruit the people in the country, in the society. They say, okay, we are the priests of Aphrodite. And they'll be in the temple, the strangers will come, they will be having sexual relationship with these people. Say, on the name of they are doing a sacrifice to worship God. It was on the name they are offering a sacrifice of worshiping their God. And recently in Arizona, in America, there is another woman who exactly wanted to start that. She even had even a room, a place where she even borrowed the place and the old prostitutes, she recruited them. And exactly doing the same thing was happening in the ancient time. It's only the police could come. I think the police came after 3-6 months and things more after she'd been operating those things and arrested, and they closed this. She was calling it a temple. These things, they are real. Now what devil does at the moment, he doesn't want to. Actually, there are many places they call a church of Satan. And I remember there's a church of Satan, there's even a particular temples where you can, they only worship at night and the people go naked at night. They are existing until now.
Yes.
But I want to inform you, all these things are Baal's activities, yes, which existed early. When you read sometime in the things in the scripture, don't think it's already passed by. It is your life until now.
Yes.
But I want the children of God to be aware and to know that God wants us to stand firm. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
What the other activities now the enemy is doing? He's now not knowing just to attack people, but he's now training people even at their night. Baal now trying to do the center right in people's life. He wants to build the center right in people's life. Little children start to be trained. Little children start to have the men, the weight, so the men or the women of the night. All these things are tactics of the enemy to prepare people to continue doing this kind of thing. But I want to let you know, our God and our Jesus is jealous of you,
amen,
and he wants to keep you for him alone.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
As I say, the activity of Baal spread it in Israel, as I said last time, it spread in Israel through this wicked king called Ahab. This man called Ahab spread this evil in the society. As I say, most of these practices, they are things that existed and keep on exist. Why do devil use particularly a sexual sin as a way to always bring evil? Because he knows it's connected with the person's body. And it's the first thing devil can do. Because he knows he can transmit demons through you by someone else. He can transmit evil through you by someone else. Therefore, when you are far away from that kind of evil, it is highly difficult for you to be possessed with particular demonic. Because you are not in contact, wherever you are in contact, or wherever you lay with someone with those powers of the Baal, Jezebel spirit, straightforward, you become possessed with that.
Amen.
Can I amen?
Amen?
Now you realize you met a particular man, I don't know where you went to play your business corner, and that man has a Jezebel spirit, gave it to you, then you return home, you are no longer a stable woman, you are no longer a stable man. That disease starts to make you to run away, to found every man you're going to find in the street, every woman found in the street, is no longer you acting. There is a Jezebel force coming and attacking. I want people, particularly men and women, girls and boys, everybody here, devil is investing in these things. But when we are away, we will know how we're going to live as a children of God. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
The Bible says your body is the temple. Jesus wants to sit in, and devil also wants to take it. Because when he takes over your body, he takes control of everything. So when, and we can listen, if devil want to kill a particular leader, a particular president, a particular powerful servant of God, a particular bishop, He will send who? Let me tell you. If devil want to kill a particular powerful servant of God, he want to kill a powerful leader of the country, he want to destroy a particular relationship, he will send who? Can I hear men? Women, I bless you from God. So let them thank God for the women. Now, because they're a blessing from God, and that's why devil is so angry about the women. Can I hear amen? I don't know if you follow the news. I don't know if you normally read your Bible. I don't know if you... Because a woman can come with aspect of weakness, but she's not coming. Actually, I always say, a woman, she's the most strongest person ever. And I want to say this to every man who's here. You don't have power.
It's true.
I say this. I repeat again. Men forget. You talk too much. You can lift 100 kilos. That is true. That is your muscles. But you have no power. A woman cannot lift 100 kilos, but she has a hidden power.
Amen.
And that power can kill you. You cannot even lift 2 kilos. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
I want you to understand why the devil always try to use a woman in order to destroy a good couple, in order to destroy a good servant of God, in order to destroy a good president. Go and read your Bible. Follow just the history. You realize all the people who failed, a woman was connected there. Do you gonna call a woman a wicked? No. A woman, she's not a wicked. A woman, she's a blessing from God. And because of what God invested in a woman, that's what devil also comes and use in order to kill men. I want you to be very careful. Not that you rebuke a woman or a girl. No. Just understand, no. It's a vessel devil can use easily to access me easily. As I say, Samson could kill hundreds, thousands, but he needed only one woman. Can I hear me? He needed one woman. And I want you to know this. Sometimes you found a person, you say, you know, a woman who is not trained by the devil, just look. Just a look. I don't know how they look. The eyes start to change. No, it's not them. Don't rebuke in the name of Jesus. No. Listen. The leader's evil coming behind. But that woman, she's totally innocent. Can I hear amen? Why do Baal use this? Why do Baal and Jezebel, your spirit is hearing this? How come Jezebel controlling Ahab? Where was Ahab? Why did Ahab did not take action? Why did Ahab did not rebuke? A king with power, with people around. How come this woman, a foreign woman? It is because the spirit of Baal was already in Jezebel. And sometimes, devil bring a particular person closer to you. And that person may look like it's coming to promise you something. That person may look like she's the best ever in the world. That person may come with a particular message, but will already be taken by Baal inside of her. You need to know that you're in the danger. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Why am I to say that the bar of force until now is open? I want to speak this message for you to know very clearly. There is now more invest, there is more, listen, the force of the enemy now is investing much in media. Media can tell you what to eat. Media will tell you who to love to vote. Media will tell you what food to eat. Media can tell you what are the good people, what are not the good people. Media now is controlling you. So what the enemy is doing, and you just check clearly, in everything they're about to attract you, they're going to use the face of a woman to the television. They want you to draw your attention. Even if it's nothing to do, even to play soccer, they'll put a woman. If a woman play rugby, whatever. This is something that has been existing and is keeping on going on. And some of us will say, it's a 21st century. Do you really think it's 21st century? When Sodom and Gomorrah got destroyed, it was this 21st century. Spirit is the same spirit. But I wanted you to know that you are children of God. And there is no anything like that one should come and enter in your life. When your children say, "Mommy, I think I'm a boy." "Yeah, you are a boy. You are right. I think I'm a girl." "Hey, how old are you?" "I'm 10. "Hey, I'm thinking I was dreaming I was a girl." "Yeah, you were a girl." Now Baal has entered in a way where people start to think differently. And they think that what they think, they need someone to support it to come to pass. Can I hear amen?
Amen.
Another character of Baal is intimidation. Jezebel, when she entered in the land, she intimidated. Listen, after Elijah killed 850 evil prophets, she said, "I will do what you've done to my prophets." Spirit of intimidation. Today there is a fear in the nation. They will silence you. Don't talk about God at your workplace. When you talk God, respect of God, maybe they'll sack me tomorrow. You're already in a life of fear just to mention God. The first thing they'll tell you, never talk religion here. The sense of fear they are putting within you. But talk rugby, talk cricket, talk whatever. Take all what you're gonna talk, but don't talk God. Bow, evil force. Then you realize when you go to the workplace, you are a stranger. You don't feel that freedom of speaking what is within your heart. You don't feel that freedom of expressing what is within you because someone is intimidating you. And I want just please let us know that we are living in a world where Baal force is forcing believers to accept what the shoe is supposed to accept. And some things we are seeing them in our own eyes. The same way, another second character of Baal is to take over, to change the way of believing. To change your way of believing.
Amen.
Some of you believe that this is not right. Some of you knew when you were born again, you knew this I cannot do. This is not right. This is not right. But because of the dominating power of Jezebel's spirit, you start to compromise some
amen,
stuff.
Amen. Amen.
Said to say, "Oh, anyway, yeah, you can do a little bit of it anywhere. Yeah." And that's why you can see there are so many gospel right now in I always say the gospel of grace, they're about to abuse it. But grace started from before. I'm the fruit of the grace of God. But because they wanted to abuse it to please people, you can do whatever you want. Don't worry, there is a grace of God upon you. You see how you understand how they're doing, huh? You can see whatever you're going to do. Don't worry. God's grace is abundant to you. but totally trying to interpret it in wrong way, which means Jezebel's spirit is stepping even the place of holiness in order to corrupt the people the way of believing. Now, what did Jezebel say? I'm going to build the altar. The Bible said she raised an altar in the land of Israel and the pole of Asherah in the country. Which means you're believing about your God. Stop about it. I'm introducing something new. And right now, some of you, what you know you shouldn't supposed to do, you are not doing it anymore. Or some, you are not doing it because anyway, there is a change. And then some people say there is a religion revolution. Others say there is the new age. Others call it the new, how can I call it? There's a new age, a religion, a revelation, church has changed. Things modernized. All these things, let me tell you, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Somebody say amen. Can I amen? Amen. So regardless what you can bring, regardless how you can explain to it, there is now Jezebel forces trying to enter inside to dilute very what you believe. But remember what you believe at the first, it is the right one. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
As I say, some of the practices of Baal, as I say, magic, ritual, traditional sacrifice. Some people, some places, they sacrifice goat, they sacrifice chicken. Other people, they go outside, they have some place they put outside, they sacrifice. Have you realized that some place you enter? Someone, amen, just someone wake up, have a good plate. They put chicken, they put fruit. They'll just leave the entrance of the house, the entrance of the yard. Many places, I want to tell for you, many places you enter, just observe just the entrance, either to the left, either to the left, or the right, sorry, there is a particular plate. Okay? There is maybe fruits there, maybe there is something there. They are sacrificing that God gonna come and take and eat. And yeah, it's a sacrifice. Now secondly, go to some shops. Go to some shops. Just enter in the shop. Don't enter quick. Just observe. There will be a particular little corner there. Just a little corner. Just enter. Can I hear man? You just go to some shops. Just don't enter. No. Just enter. Observe. You see that little stuff there? There's some stuff they put there. What they say, we are sacrificing to our evil gods to come and take. And tomorrow, the first thing they will do, they will replace. They will bring another one. Now, those things they are putting there, they will get rotten. But they want to put another one. So what did the gods eat? Nothing. Would you see how devil blind people?
Yeah.
They'll leave it there. These are sacrifice. There's another sacrifice of money. It's occult. Occult is common.
Yeah.
As I said, there's also sacrifice, sexual sacrifices. There's a witchcraft. There's consulting the fortune teller, palm readers, consulting the doctors. Not the doctors, consulting the witch doctors. And then also consulting to offering a particular image. Also, you see some people say, I'm going to a fortune teller to tell me. To the palm reader, the fortune teller. All these things are practices that happen to bow himself. Can I amen?
Amen.
Other people bowing down before a particular image. Just a particular shape is there. Then someone dressing well, like Pastor Lolo. Then he goes, yeah, I'm dressed well. You see someone bowing down to a particular piece of the tree. A normal person, well educated, went to school, is bowing down to a tree. Can I amen?
Amen.
A tree which means it was a piece of tree. They just shape it. Then they make an image, either of a person, image, either of a woman, image, either of a cow, and then you see a good, well-educated person. You go there and bow and go.
When we read this one, we think these people were not normal. They were in the old school. Even those who are still in the new school. Somebody say amen. Tell your neighbor, I'm happy because I'm free. There is no blanket in my eyes. I'm clearly seeing.
Hallelujah.
All these are the practices that were taking place. God wants us to submit only to Him. God wants us to offer only to Him. God wants us to ask a question only to Him. Actually, there is this son of Ahab, the son of Ahab himself, the first Kings chapter 1, verse 1. Because this child was born in a house where he can only see people acting funny stuff. So he grew up knowing that consulting the evil, doing the evil, that's the best way. And the Bible says one day he fell down and then he had an injury. And then I think it's Isaiah. And when he had an injury, and then he asked the people to go and consult the Baal to tell him if he will live. As they were going, they met with Elijah. This is a child of a father who was Ahab. So that's what I'm saying. As a parent, whatever you do, that's what your children will believe. Can I hear amen?
Amen.
This child grow up in a house, knows, oh, that's what we do. Listen, if your life in the morning, you start with a long beer, in the evening, long beer, in the night, a long beer, your child knows this is the good way to follow. Can I understand? Can I hear
amen?
If you take your phone, someone calling, are you there? And you tell your child, your child knows this is the best way to do. The child also, one day you yourself gonna call him. You yourself. And he'll tell his young brother, so everything you are doing, don't think you're fooling yourself. It's gonna come back to yourself. Somebody say amen. Everything. When you go with your child on the road, how are you? People greet you, oh, well, good. Then, after the person, my child, do you know this man? He's a very dangerous man. When you meet him the way you saw, never greet him. He's very, very dangerous. You see what the child is going to do? One day you're going to meet that man. Oh, how are you? You're the one in my mommy said you're dangerous. So everything that you do, the child believe is true. Why? You are a little God to that child. When you play clever game, you think, ah, he's just a kid. He's a kid. Some people, kid. Yeah, he's a kid. The child is recording. This is what I think is right. Listen, there's one sermon is coming about being honest. You know, you don't need to teach your child to be honest. Your child wants to see. Your mom is honest. My dad is honest. So this child grow up and see a God grow up in a family where they can only do evil. He grew up in a family where the mom is a Jezebel, the dad is a Ahab. So this child grow up in a family where all the demons of Jezebel are in the country. Actually, they are not all in the land, they are also in the bedroom. He could see all the statue everywhere. Then one day the dad is dying. Now he's the one who to become a king. The Bible said the first thing, Second Kings chapter 1. Chapter, just that, First Kings chapter 1, verse 1. The introduction of him. They say that he fall down. And one day, when the king David, Second Kings chapter 1. After Ahab's death, Moab rebelled against Israel. Continue. Now Ahaziah had fallen through the lattice of his upper room in Samaria and injured himself. So he sent messengers saying to them, go and consult who? Baal-zebul. Baal-zebul is also
another name of Baal. Okay? There's a basketball of Baal. There's a different places. Now, here, the son, because the mother, the father, touched the child, the first incident is happening. Go and consult him. Now, can you read to three? Let's go three. Chapter 1, verse 3. But the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, go up and meet the messengers of the king of Samaria and ask them, is it because there is no God in Israel that you are going off to consult Baal? And that's why sometimes situations happen, issues happen, and then your family will tell you, go and consult this one old man, this one man in a community there. Where I came before I came to Australia, I left here somewhere there. Can you go consult him and ask him why my situation is this? That's exactly what this king did. I will say God was very angry. When you are a child of God and you are looking for some people, some evil people, to tell you your future, to tell you what is happening, God is not happy. And I can tell you definitely, God said, before I spoke to Footray, you see this man when he sent the people? Number one, the people he sent, innocent people, they died. Because Elijah called the fire on top of them. The first group was 51, they died. This king was still stubborn because he didn't know anything about God. He never knew a God. Listen, he never knew God. Actually, I don't know why Elijah called the fire on him. He never know God because he grew up, was born, is Jezebel there. Actually, sending this message, Jezebel see you in the palace. So when you consult, when you talk to any person, or any person say, okay, I'm going to do this on your behalf. Don't worry, I'll pay my money. Say, stop. I don't want. Can I amen?
Amen.
So many pastors and many churches, dead places. Pastors are preaching and they are talking about the forces of the enemy somewhere there. People are coming, I love God, I love God. And this, you know, this is our traditional, we're going to do it. You have God, you have Baal. You have God, you have Baal. You have God, you have Baal. Can I hear me?
Amen.
I know who I'm talking to. God wants you to let him to take over completely. Somebody say, amen.
Amen.
Now, there are sometimes the enemy tries to visit you in the night. You have to take total control. Before I go there, I said ritual act, traditional act of sacrifice, anything that is a traditional, but that traditional has no beginning and the end. Reject it. I always say again, and last Sunday I spoke, reject it. Totally reject it. Because that traditional is simple. You are continuing to renew the contracts of someone who made it the first time.
Yes. Amen.
Do you know what we do? The Holy Communion?
Yes.
Holy Communion is a tradition for the believers. Because Jesus said, do this in the remembrance of
me.
Every time we eat Holy Communion, we are sitting, we are renewing.
Amen.
Can I amen?
Amen?
Every time you see the Holy Communion, you are eating, understand Jesus is there. And the disciples are there. We are renewing. Do this in the remembrance of me. Renew the covenant. And every time you carry on a particular tradition which is wrong, you are renewing a particular evil that has been for many years. And here before I finish, how you can, as I say, God's response to people who worship the Baal. Number one, he destroyed them. Destroyed them. There is one king. We have two kings. The first one I said, after consulting God, was not happy and definitely he died. There was another king, King Saul, who went to consult a sorcerer. And after consulting him and the children, they went to the battlefield. They did not return. God allowed them to die. Every time there is any consultation of evil, God becomes very angry. And I say this day, the day where God wanted to punish them 24,000, they died because God does not want you to share with any other power, with any other thing. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Although Baal's worshippers intimidated, They came with intimidation, although Baal was intimate, because I remember Baal was a god of thunder, god of earthquake, god of fire. And this now God wants now to take revenge. And then he said, Elijah, ask them to choose God, to choose the sacrifice. If really this Baal is God, because he's a god of thunder, they call him god of thunder, they call him god of this one. Now I want you to show something. And he said, okay, if he's a really god of power, I want to see that power today. If he's a really god of fire, I want to see that fire today. He said, okay, you guys, you are 850 and one. You're going to choose, we're going to choose. We are going to see who is really a god.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Now Elijah came and said, we're going to choose how to see who is a really god. Amen. Because you say you are fearing him. He's a god of thunder, god of fire. Now something will happen.
Amen.
850 evil prophets started. Bala, 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 bala. If you go to a particular place, people, there's so much making noise as a way of worshiping. You know what Elijah was doing? Elijah was calm. Maybe sleeping under the tree. Maybe, because he knew these people. They're just making noise. Then he went to them, hey! Maybe your God is sleeping. Maybe he went to a genie. Cry louder. Maybe he's still sleeping. And he started to play a game with them. They indeed cried louder. The Bible said they start to cut themselves. Let me tell you, any information you get from any person who's not in God is totally a demonic fake lie. Can I hear amen?
Amen?
Can I hear amen?
Amen?
Can I hear amen?
Amen?
And I will say, and I want to tell anybody here, there is no magic, no power, no forces can resist the power of Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen!
Amen.
It's the matter of when you want to show God, to show the enemy that they're just an enemy. The reason why sometimes you make the force of the enemy to feel powerful is because when you start to fear them, when you start to fear a particular atmosphere, you fear a particular thought, you fear a particular dream, you fear a particular sin. Then when you fear, then exactly fear suppress you down. And then you made evil start to act. But I want to tell you, there is a power within you. Somebody say amen. Tell everybody, ever. There is a power in you. There is a power in you. There is a power in you. There is a fire in you. There is a fire in you. There is a power in you. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Don't go outside. They are looking for you. Are you sure? Yeah, yeah. While there's nobody looking at outside, if you try to move there, they will kill you. And then, yeah, and that's how the devil comes.
Yes.
He comes in people's mind. He tried to tell you something, he trained you something. The day you're gonna do this, you're gonna die. It's totally fake. Can I amen?
Amen.
Then Brother Israel, who's stuck here, he told me, if I just say, they'll kill me. If I go out, they'll kill me. Well, there's nothing. Nothing at all. Why? Because he's accepting fear. But if he can say, me, never. When he starts to come, me, never. My voice will start to go out. Because I know I'm lying. Do you understand? And he said, I'll set up to go. Because I know I was lying. And the things you can only do when sometime before something will try to intimidate you, you just use the boldness of God within you and say, no, I will go and see what is happening. Somebody say, amen.
Amen.
Bible say they cut themselves, they cried blood, they do what they could. But was not there. It was fake stuff they made there. But I can tell you, devil is real. Amen.
Amen.
Devil is real. But his reality is no power for you. It's like nothing for you if you're in Christ. But if you're not in Christ, devil is real. But if you're sitting in Christ, it's totally useless to you. Because the power of God is beyond any other power. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Simple, Elijah came and said, okay, give me my time. Do you know yourself?
the prayer of Elijah. I'm here because to show the response of God to deal with Baal. The Bible said fire came and destroyed. And the world could believe, so this is a real God who answers by fire. The one we used to fear was not a God. And I want to let you know, whatever can try to come, it may look like it's real, but it's not real. You just stand in God. Somebody say, amen.
Amen.
Similarly, it was in God. We would consider him as the God of rain, God of fertility. At this moment, they are crying. Like you said, Elijah declared, 3 years and a half, there will be no rain. And the rain never came. Where was this God Baal? For 3 years and a half, no rain. Even if they could come, Baal is the God of fertility, God of rain. But Elijah said, I will show you that I'm the one that can control by the word of God. No rain, and indeed, no rain.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Where was this God of fertility? Where was this God of harvest? Was not there. It was fake. But I can tell you, when you are sitting in God, why do you think the Israelites were believing that it was real? Because all of them, they were already outside of God. They needed only one person to believe that God was real. And that's what the Bible says, surely it's true. Some of the situations you're going through, you believe they start to act as real because you are out of God. But when you connect to God, you're going to realize every situation that tried to come on your way is totally useless. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
How to overcome Baal or Jezebel's spirit influence? Number one, denounce the influence. Never keep in under the carpet. Just denounce and say, this is evil, I refuse it. Denounce any secrets. Anything that might try to train you in the night, maybe in the evening, maybe someone telling you, denounce it. That's number one, to destroy. Because when you keep it, it grow up within you. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Destroy any mark of Jezebel. Destroy any mark of Beelzebub. And this is how God, as I'm finishing, this is how God called Gideon. After God calling Gideon, he said, Gideon, I'm about to use you. But one thing, go and destroy the altar of Baal that your dad built. I'm about to use you, Gideon. The Bible says, said to him, go and destroy the altar. And when he destroyed the altar, he was ready to be used by God. The altar is simply anything that you believe to, anything that you think that definitely this one I bow to, something that you say actually this what my I. The altar is a place where you put your thoughts, your mind, you believe something that it existed. It wasn't Gideon who built the altar, it was the Father. But God said, destroy it. Can I amen?
Amen.
For you to be free from any influence of Jezebel or Baal. Number one, reject any initiative. Number two, refuse and destroy every little thing you already started. Devil doesn't need a big space. He only needs a little room. Just a little room where he will enter through. And that little room, he will start to take the territory bigger and bigger. But I want you to know, God invested in you. And he wants you to remain for him. May God bless you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.